WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
A boy's born in hot dog, Mississippi, surrounded by four walls that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes to scrub the floors for many, and you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough for the city.
We are back every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB. It's the Frank M. Conaway Sr. at our show with co-host, Attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore. Thank you for joining us again this second hour. The first hour, we had Dr. Analeta Peterson talk to us about maternal mortality. If you want to review or hear what she had to say, feel free to go to YouTube, check out our podcast. All you have to do is type in Frank Conaway Senior Show. It will come up. You can listen to it on your phone, your computer, or on your television. I am an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. The services that we provide are real estate and estate planning. So if you need assistance with purchasing your ground rent, updating your deal or your deed or your will, or buying or selling your property, give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you're listening and would like to make a comment or have a question and you can't get through in the phone lines, please text me at 667-334-7242. And just in a way of an announcement, if you have a young kid between first grade and fifth grade and you're looking for a summer camp, The Hope Academy is having an AAA summer camp, which means academics, athletic, and arts. It's a six-week camp from June the 20th to July the 28th, grades 1 through 5, and it's Monday through Friday, 7:30 to 3:30, with aftercare available. So if you need more information, please contact me directly, or you can reach out at 410-327-9020, 410-327-9020, and there is opportunity to get financial assistance if you meet certain income guidelines. So check it out. Call me if you need any additional information.
All right. And co-host, Attorney Robert Bob, the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning again, and ain't nothing changed.
Yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number is 410-669-1738. I want to take this time just to thank those of you who came out last Sunday at Gillis Memorial as we celebrated some of the legends of gospel music in this town. I mean, we almost packed Gillis out. We almost packed it out. It made my heart so gratified. I saw folk I haven't seen since Gillis was down on Calhoun and Marbury Street, and that's when I joined 60 years ago. It was really, really wonderful. We plan to keep this thing going every year. We're trying to put together a 501c3 foundation for gospel legends. right now. And if you guys missed it, some of it is on Facebook. You might can pick it up. I tell you, if you missed it this year, I would not recommend that you miss next year. We'll have a whole slew of different people involved in that. Also, want to announce the passing of Attorney Station figure, Mrs. Phyllis Sewell, passed away yesterday. Now, arrangements are not complete. Yes, I will have arrangements by next week for Ms. Sewell, who is also a relative of mine, but well-known in that Turner Station area. Okay? All right. We're getting ready to go back to the phones. We're coming to Henry and Rashid. We got some lines open, 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. A lot of things to talk about. Your governor, Wes Moore, was on some national syndicated TV shows the other day, and he was worried about the debt ceiling problem, saying that if they defaulted on that, that it would affect Maryland in a great way, since there are a lot of government offices here in Maryland that pay government salaries, and if they default, somebody ain't getting paid. You have right now announced on the Democratic side running for president is Mr. Biden and Robert F. Kennedy Jr. On the Republican side, we now have, of course, Donald J. Trump, Nikki Haley, Asa Hutchinson, Tim Scott just announced that he will be running for the presidency. And the other day, the governor of Florida had a botched get started thing on announcing that he was going to run for president. Him and the Musk guy got together.
Elon.
Yeah, Elon. And he was supposed to be coming on Twitter to 140-something million subscribers, as Elon Musk likes to say. And when they got ready to announce, the technical problems happened. And they want to say that they, you know, their circuits was overloaded and they couldn't get through. But it seemed to me, I agree with Whoopi. Didn't you not test things out before you started it? You got a big announcement like this getting ready to go down, and you don't test your equipment. Come on, give me a break. So now you have DeSantis, Asa Hutchinson, Nikki Haley, Donald Trump, and they expect possibly Pence to jump in on that side. The guy out of Virginia, Youngkin, Governor Youngkin. And it was interesting to see Sununu, the governor of Vermont, or is it New Hampshire, on The View the other day. But they got him on one question that he did not answer, I think, satisfactorily. And I'll give kudos to Whoopi, who, when he gave the answer, the crowd, the audience started to boo him, and she immediately stopped the booing because she said, we need to hear from both sides what they think and to understand why they think like they think. So it was very interesting, and everybody's waiting to see if Sununu is going to jump in. Along with the presidential election, you're going to have a major mayor's election here in Baltimore. And the only person I've heard announced thus far is Brandon. Now, all we can do is speculate on other people, okay? But whoever's running, they need to hurry up and come on out here. That's what I got to say.
I agree.
All right. We got some lines open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Yeah, Tehma.
One caller texted in, and I know we haven't covered this topic. What do you think about Clarence Thomas accepting hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of gifts from billionaires, including a home for his mother, which the guy owns?
I think it's despicable. Yeah. I mean,
he's
bought and paid for. And now, in addition to that, Crow, his benefactor, has refused to provide the Senate Judiciary Committee, Senator Duburn, any information disclosing the extent, the amount, and timing of any of the contributions that he made to Thomas and his wife Jenny over the last 20 years. And so now the consideration is whether or not the Senate is going to actually subpoena Crow to provide the documentation. But Crow said, told them, he couldn't disclose the information because he doesn't believe that Congress has the right to legislate ethics for members of.
Who was this?
This is his Crow. The one who gave the money to Clarence.
Oh, the guy that was hooked up with Clarence.
He's
the billionaire.
The Senate asked him to appear and to provide documentation for how much gifts he'd given him, and he refused. Yeah. So the question is, where's going? I think Clarence Thomas. At least this is the first time there's a real explanation. I thought it was just whatever, but now that I know he's bought and paid for, I don't expect any different.
Well, it seems that he ain't the only one bought and paid for.
He's not.
It seems that this whole court is off the chain. Now, I just found out this morning or yesterday that Robert's wife earned $10 million from law firms and other entities who had direct hookups with the court. So it's a whole lot of funky stuff going on with this majority conservative court.
Well, the notion that you can separate a person from the beliefs and their morals is ludicrous to begin with. Mm-hmm. The notion that just because you put a robe on, all of a sudden you're sanctified is ludicrous. The fact of the matter is, if I was controlled by money and moneyed interest before I became a judge, I got the same control after I became a judge. If I was a racist before I went on the bench, I'm still a racist when I'm on the bench. Mm. So the notion that somehow or another people rise to the level of the position that they're supposed to hold is completely specious, in my opinion.
But in this day and time, aren't people put on the Supreme Court based on their quote-unquote morals?
No.
When you put a conservative on the court, you know that you have the expectation that they will vote against abortion. When you put someone who's not a conservative on the court, you know you have the expectation that they will vote for abortion. So those are, this is how I feel emotionally. And then they duke it out to see what laws will either bridge the gap or who wins.
Well, first of all, you know you got a problem when you got five of the six Catholics on there.
But that's what I'm saying. Okay. When you pick someone conservative,
you know what you're getting.
Right, so you don't really separate that in this day and time when you appoint a Supreme Court justice, even though that might be what they're supposed to do, you know going in what way they're going to be swayed based on their morals.
I don't. That's what I'm saying. I don't think there is any way to separate them. And I think that the people who come out and say I'm picking this person because they believe what I believe are the most honest of all. I think that the issue of abortion, there happened to be a case that everybody could circle wagons around Roe v. Wade and so forth. They could all point to, But Thomas's issue is not about a specific case. It's about his whole mentality. It's about his mindset.
Right.
Everything. Because when you get down into the weeds, if you eliminate the extremes in the middle, everybody's about the same. I mean, if you just say I'm against abortion, most people, even those who say they're against it, will say, okay, there's an exception. If there's rape, some of them will, some of them won't. Somebody will say there's an exception for this. Someone will, some of them won't. So the problem with Clarence Thomas is, in my opinion, he's bought and paid for. And the same is true, not just for him, but for Roberts and many of the other ones.
Alito.
Oh, yeah.
This is another one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Kavanaugh should have never been on there in the first place.
Yeah.
Neither should
Why should he be on? Because of what he did in college?
Yeah.
That's debatable.
But that ain't the only thing. They had other evidence on him, but the FBI never went to uncover it. The whole thing was fixed.
That's what most of the politicians.
Yeah, I think there's so much hypocrisy. So much hypocrisy involved. I think they ought to remember the glass house theory.
That you live in?
Don't throw rocks.
Henry, you on air?
The clinic part. As many clinics do prior to practices false abortion, but we have a few of our clinics do it. That's the part that I was kind of interested in. And I've been hearing the Catholics, they talking about that kind of thing. A lot of their ministries deal with that. So I take my comment off there. Thanks for taking my call.
Oh, you're more than welcome. Thank you for calling. Okay. We got some lines open. 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. Rashid, you're on air.
Yes, good morning, everyone. Yeah, Carlton, you mentioned something about, you ready to talk about Tina Turner and Jim Brown, but I'm going to talk about Jim Brown. I met him in the early 70s at my Muhammad Ali's training camp when my cousin Larry Holmes was a sparring partner. And then I'm going to tell you something else about Jim Brown. Is we don't have these kind of guys these days because he was part of the civil rights movement. And then in the 80s and the 90s, he would invite, because he lived in Los Angeles, he would invite rival gang members from the Bloods and the Crips to his home to negotiate how we're going to straighten this out on the streets.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So that's, we don't have those kind of leaders these days. You know what I mean? Because I've been around strong guys. Yeah, because my brother was a member of the Black Panther Party, and he got assassinated he was part of the COINTELPRO, and they shot my brother 83 times with machine gun fire.
Wow.
You know what I mean? So I have been around strong black men, but I don't see that here in our city. I don't see no strong leaders like that. Hey, Carlton, why don't you step up to the plate and run for mayor, Carlton?
Are you kidding me? First of all, I don't even live in the city no more, so I ain't hardly interested in being no mayor. I'd rather be a kingmaker than a king.
And in Baltimore, we do have a lot of strong black men. They just don't get the media and public attention,
right.
You know, that a lot of other men get because they're in the background doing the heavy lifting and the hard lifting.
Yep. Okay, we got a couple lines open, 410-481-1010. We're going to Steven. Steven, you on air.
Hello, I'd like to ask a question. Elon Musk, wasn't he born in Africa, South Africa?
Yeah, I think he was.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Why can't he become president? Because that's what
How can he become what?
Wait a minute, he's not running for president.
No.
He's not running. He was trying to help DeSantis announce his running for president.
Oh, I thought he was running.
No.
No, but you mentioned Obama. You're right. Because if it hadn't been for Obama, Musk would still be trying to figure out how to make a battery in his garage.
Well, thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Steve.
One topic that's coming up over the Memorial Day weekend is the youth curfew. And I know a lot of people are waiting to see a lot of stuff in Baltimore. Number one, we're waiting to see if there's been success with the Squeegee Kids initiative in terms of when the weather gets warmer, are they going to return to the corners or are they not going to return to the corners? Those particular intersections, or are they going to move their locations? Now, with the curfew coming up over the weekend, we want to see how is that going to be handled. Is it going to be effective? Is it going to deter the kids from coming out?
Well, I want to hear from a lot of these mothers that are out there. It's getting ready to get warmer. School is going to be closing. And what plans do you have for your children when they're out of school and want to go out and play and you don't know if they're going to come back alive or not? I'd like to hear from some of you mothers out there that got something to say about it. And some fathers, too. I mean, you know, if you're parenting, which you ought to be, and one of the problems we're having with the juvenile situation, because parenting to some is not being done.
And as parents, Baltimore does offer a lot of opportunities, whether it's youth work, where your kids can work during the summer, or whether, you know, you enroll them in a summer camp, and the Baltimore City has different programs that assist you in paying for that child care summer camp program during the course of the summer. So definitely look out for your kids. Make sure they're being entertained in a safe environment.
Well, what do y'all think about, first of all, the curfew thing is not legal. You can't lock anybody up for that. But what is the two of you as our legal eagles think about it, and especially as you as a mother of a young man?
I believe that the Baltimore City government needs to be transparent. But part of the transparency is a lot of times you cannot tell them these are the laws, these are the rules, but don't worry about them because we can't do anything if you don't obey the laws or the rules, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think there needs to be some type of tough talk, knowing that you can ease up on the end versus, you know, giving them standards and then reversing any consequences during the same time that you're giving them standards. Like your mother always threatened, I'm going to beat your butt. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. That's a threat, right? Now, whether she did it or not afterwards, she could always have the option of backing down. But a lot of times with that threat, you straightened up and you behaved so you wouldn't know the consequences. But now you have a curfew, but you're telling the kids if you don't, you know, obey the curfew, there's nothing we can do.
Yeah.
So how is that going to work? How do you expect their behavior to change from what has been in the last couple of weeks or the last couple of months? Plus, the curfew only takes place after 9 o'clock. So if a group of teenagers wanted to go to Bondarman Mall or downtown or wherever during the day, what will be done then? So it's a lot of loopholes that are not, I don't think, efficient enough for it to have any bite or any enforcement or to make anything better for the city or for the youth to have a safe place without, you know, encountering people who don't want them to be there.
Bob, what's that?
There's so many reasons why it doesn't make any sense. I wouldn't even know where to start to list them. In addition to what Tehma says, first of all, the people who would adhere to the curfew were not the ones who were worried about engaging in activity anyway.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right. And the ones who are not going to adhere to the curfew are not. There's no way to stop them because they don't walk around with signs on saying I'm going to do something wrong. And then if you stop them, you know, then you're not going to arrest them. You got to take them somewhere. And then and nobody's monitoring them, so they're going to be back on. I mean, it's all politics. It's all show. It's dog and pony show to make people think you're doing something when the reality is it's not going to. I don't believe that it's going to accomplish anything at all except maybe set the stage for a different kind of problem or an unintended consequence or maybe an intended consequence that has nothing to do with the original purpose of the so-called.
Yes.
We got to stop. We got to stop doing something just because we say, okay, well, we got to do something. No, you got to do the right thing, not just something to be doing it. And this is another one of those examples of just doing something to be doing it because it might look and sound good. We're not going to accomplish anything, in my opinion.
Well, I think you're right. There's so much stuff that's going on out here.
And I think another thing is, how are you going to have midnight basketball games when kids are supposed to be in the house at 11 o'clock? You know, I'm all for basketball games, you know, having entertainment for the kids. But why have them after curfew time? Why have them or invite them out on the streets of Baltimore in the middle of the night? Have it, but have it earlier so it can end and they can get home by curfew. You can't have activities that negate the curfew that you're trying to set up.
Yeah.
All right, let's go to, we got a couple lines open, 410-481-1010. We're coming in this order right now. Joe, Diane, Robert. And if you got something you got to say, call in 410-481-1010. Let's go to Joe. You on air, Joe.
Good afternoon. How y'all doing?
Fine.
You know, here's the elephant in the room as far as the Supreme Court is concerned. Now, when they sit in front of their confirmation hearings, now, they took an oath. They violated that because when they said Roe versus Wade is the law of the land,
yep,
and they will not touch it. So that means
they didn't say that. No. They did. No one said that. No, all they said was they would respect and enforce the law as it was. They never said that if a case came before them involving it, they wouldn't vote to change the law. They never said that.
No, they didn't.
Okay. Well, that's an error on my part.
Okay.
You know,
okay.
Because I look at when they violate the oath, that's lying to Congress.
Well, everybody who was on the court when Dred Scott was decided took the same oath.
Yep.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
What's the name? Taney.
Roger Taney. The oath hasn't changed. That's what I'm trying to tell you. You put the robe on and take an oath, that doesn't change who you are or what you believe.
Exactly. But here's another point.
Go ahead.
Kavanaugh's a drunk. Robbins have epilepsies. You know, they got all these unqualified people sitting on that court.
Have you ever seen Kavanaugh take a drink?
No, because...
Well, then don't call him a drunk. Talk about things that you personally know about. Don't come on here repeating stuff that other people have said without any verification.
Yeah, because I haven't heard that. He might have had his over problems when he was younger, being accused of those sexual harassments that he had. But I wouldn't, describe him as what you just said.
I've never seen a man take a drink. I don't know whether he drinks. I don't know whether he drinks at all.
Well, he did admit to what's her name? That senator questioned him. He did admit to her that he liked beer.
Okay.
He liked his beer and everything. At the hearing, he admitted that.
Yeah, that doesn't make him a drunk, though.
Yeah, that don't make him a drunk, though. He didn't admit that he had an alcohol problem.
Oh, okay. Well, I understand your point on that, for real. You know, and I have to recant my statement.
Okay, Joe. Appreciate
you. See
you
later.
Bye.
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's go to Robert. Robert, you on the air.
Hello, panel. I think that the mayor's curfew plan, to me, it makes about as much sense as putting screen doors on a submarine. I don't. It's not going to work. I mean, how does a police officer tell whether you're 13, 14, or 16? There is no way. And the police have enough problems with serious crime than to try to babysit a bunch of juveniles that go downtown. Now, one thing I do know about, and that's Phil's point, I used to love to go down there, but this was back in the 80s and the early 90s. Go down, have dinner on the weekends, me and my lady, go have a few beers, dance, have a good time. And you had no fear of walking around Phil's Point. But now you got this herd of young people coming down there. And why they come down here with those dirt bikes? And, Mayor, I'm going to tell you one thing. You need to get rid of these dirt bikes. Get a law passed where you can't have them in your house. If they find them on your property, in your house, your adult in the house gets 90 days. Juvenile Protective Services takes the young people out of the house. And one thing is for sure. If the junkies will tell you where the bikes is, if you put a $100 bounty on them, just have them sign a paper. You get their ID and they get a number. They get paid when the police go get the bike. And the adult, if you got a job, you do 90
so,
days.
So wait a second. You want to make it illegal for me to buy and own a dirt bike? Is that what you're saying?
Well,
I mean, just answer the question. Is that what you're saying?
One
I thought it already was. No.
It's illegal to ride one in the streets, right. But I don't think it's like, illegal to own one.
Oh.
Well, anybody who make an analogy between stealing sunglasses out of a drugstore and young people who steal cars that end up committing crimes with murder, you have a serious disconnect from the beginning. Now, I mean, okay. They ride these bikes. If you want to get rid of them, that's how to get rid of them.
Make it illegal to buy and own a dirt bike. Okay.
So now you're saying it's not illegal to...
It's not illegal to buy one or to
But it's illegal to ride one.
On a public thoroughfare.
On a public thoroughfare.
Right.
Okay. All right. Because it seemed to me that they looked like they were hunting for these dirt bikes, and I was under the impression that it was illegal to even own one.
No.
So it's not?
No.
Okay. But it's illegal to ride one
on a public thoroughfare.
On a public thoroughfare.
That's why they're talking about trying. There was some consideration being given to actually building a dirt bike
That's
track.
That's what I heard too.
Where they could take them and legally use them.
But the question would be, how do they get them to the dirt bike track?
Good question.
That is a good question.
I got some suspicions about how to get there.
I know how they're going to get there, but if they get there that way, what's the point?
We got a couple lines open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. We're going to Diane, then Ken. Diane, you on air.
Yes, good morning to everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Carlton, I'm almost like you about the dirt bikes. Years ago, they said that it was illegal in Baltimore City. You can have it in all the other counties, but Baltimore City was illegal. And remember, I think it was Kirk Smoke, one of the mayors, they were having so many accidents with the police cars, they told the police not to chase after them. Right. Only they can get them at a red light or when they stop at a gas station to fill up or at a store or something like that, they can get them then because they was telling them not to chase after them because they're not going to pay for no more cars being wrecked by the chasing after the dirt bikes. That's what I heard. But I called in because sometimes we don't give enough things to the parents to do to take care of their children. They had those children. And all the parents are not alike. Like people are saying, well, they don't care, you know, you can't find. That's not true. You have a lot of parents that care about their children, but they're not reinforcing what they should. Like, they should have their own curfew for their children. You should know where your child is at, unless you're working. Even when you're working, I know my mom worked from, she worked 6 to 2, 6 at night. She was a barmaid. She called to make sure that we were in the house where my grandmother was in there. And she made sure that our dinner was already ready. All I had to do was warm it up. And we didn't have microwaves back there. But my mom, she had enough. She knew where we were at all times. And if she didn't know where we were at, we had to explain ourselves and stuff like that. You know, but we give the children too much credit in today's time. We want them to raise themselves. And then when things go wrong, we still blame them. What about the adults in their life? They do have some adults in their life that are not capable of handling their own children. So then that's when juvenile services come in. And we don't, somebody talked about, I think last week or the week before, about the judges and the probation officers. That's how the crime, the probation officers are not doing their job, even with the older people. You know, if your client is not reporting, you're supposed to violate them. But they are not doing that because they said the juveniles will be overcrowded. So what do you do? It's like you want the citizens in Baltimore to listen to what you're saying, but it's not getting no better with the youth curfew.
Well, we thank you, Diane, but I think what needs to be done, parents need to parent. I think that's a major obstacle that's going on here. Why would these kids be 13, 14, 15, 16, out after 10, 11 o'clock, even later than that, whether it be down the harbor, whether it be down Phelps Point, I don't care where it is, and your parent don't know where you are. Then when something happened to you, they jumping up and down doing flips and acrobatic things about, oh, my child. Well, if you had been on top of what your child was doing, who they were hanging with, you may not have had this problem. What do y'all say about that?
No parent can control their kids after a certain point in time.
I agree.
And what your kids do as they grow older depends upon the beliefs and the values and the things that you taught them almost
and
from the time.
Them.
And instilled them
yeah.
when they were much younger.
Yeah.
By the time they get 15, it's all over.
It's all over.
It was over
13.
By the time they got
yeah.
right.
13.
Yeah. Right, right, yep. right, right, yep. right, right, right. Yep. You know, and the kids, they go to the harbor because that's where the action is.
Yeah.
There's no life out in the communities where they live. They can't. In the summertime, it's 100 degrees. They got no air conditioning. They ain't going to sit in the house.
Ain't no whole lot of recreation.
They go where the action is.
Yeah.
And just because you see a group of 10 young black kids.
Don't mean this
don't,
trouble.
Don't mean they're coming there to do nothing to you.
Right.
They're friends and relatives.
Yeah.
You know, so I can't, you know, I'm not responsible for irrational fears.
And here's a situation. A parent friend of mine has a teenager. They miss curfew at the house.
Mm.
So they go home and the parents said, you miss curfew, you staying out. Kid walking away down the street runs into the police. What does the police do? Pick the kid up.
Bring him home.
Take him home and say, look, he's a minor.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He has to go in your house.
House.
So
yep.
who's in charge of your house now?
Man.
Yeah.
You're the parent, the kid,
Hello.
Who now knows he could come and go as he wants
yep.
and he can't get put out. So, I mean, a lot falls on the parents, but like you said,
man.
Once they turn 13, unless they have the fear of their parents in them
right.
that you've installed from the time that they were born,
right.
then there's really nothing that you can do about
yep.
it. And just to clarify on the dirt bike law, in the state of Maryland, a dirt bike must be registered and tagged like any other motor vehicle. In addition, you must have insurance covering your bike in case of an accident. While riding a dirt bike on the street is often illegal, it is legal to ride them as you please on private property without
right.
insurance or a license.
Right.
But in Baltimore City, it says no person may drive or ride any dirt bike or unregistered motorcycle or similar vehicles on any public or private property that is located in Baltimore City. So with that said, how many of these dirt bikes do you think are registered?
None.
Or have legal
tags? I ain't
saying
a dirt bike. I haven't seen too many with a license on it.
Nah,
right. So
nah.
License plate on it.
So it's illegal for them to have one if it's not registered or licensed
right.
on a public or a private property.
Right.
So I guess if it's on a private property in your yard, you can get it if it's an unregistered vehicle.
Whoa, okay. Ken, you're on air.
Hello?
You're on.
All right, good morning.
Good morning.
All right, I'm going to make a couple comments real quick. One thing is, I just can't see them enforcing this curfew. And I got a couple. Okay, my thing is, I was young too. I don't know what this infatuation with guns is. Where are these young folks getting these guns from? Like, who would sell a young kid a gun? A teenager a gun? I don't understand the mindset of people. I know people can always try to make money. But, you know, why would you sell a young folk a gun? And where is this infatuation with guns coming from? When I was growing up, you know, it was very rare that you saw a gun as a young folk. Or, you know, the young person, let alone want to touch a gun. You knew that most likely something bad was going to happen. It was not going to be a good outcome. You know, and they said it was like, I heard them say it was $1.8 million to do this program. I'm curious, why didn't they just take some of that money and make a dirt bike track? So that way, and have a concessions out there, that way you put these kids in the area, you know where they at. At least you got them in an area where you can see where they at and know what they doing, you know. And what happens when a police officer try to enforce this and take them way over on the other side of town? How they gonna get back home? How can a young person? How the parent ain't got no money? How they gonna get the child back home? You know, that don't make no sense. I don't believe it was well thought out. I don't know who gonna get this money, but there's some stealing involved in this. You know, I mean. I don't understand how they take all this money, they say it was 1.8, and don't do something else better with it. I mean, this doesn't, none of it makes sense.
Thank you, Ken. Appreciate you. Got a good point there. First of all that money he got during the COVID, that what was it, $648 million that he was given?
Yeah, but it's actually more than that. But yeah, that was one, that was initial.
Yeah. And you couldn't take something somewhere and make sure that these folk had a field they could go to and do their thing without being on the street endangering everybody.
Well, just like the squeegee thing. I mean, spending all of this money. If it were me, here's the intersection. I would do a carve out, right? On the lane away from the middle. I would do a carve out. If you wanted your windshield washed, you pull out of the traveled lane, pull over, wipe your lane. The squeegee kids could not move from that. I'm trying to move them from the intersection. I'm trying to keep them from stopping and interfering with the flow of traffic. So make a safe place for them to go. And anybody who doesn't pull over, what does that say to you? That means they don't want their windshield touched. That means if you go out to touch it, you're going to get locked up. But this whole idea of picking them up, taking them to a center, feeding them and giving them a $200 check and then letting them go and wait, and then they do the same thing the next day, that's just ridiculous. It makes no sense at all.
Yeah, when it comes to the squeegee kids, before they had squeegee kids, you had kids out on the corner selling water and chips. Yeah. But no one complained.
Right.
They didn't interfere. They didn't touch your property without permission. I mean, if anything, you know, it's good to have them off the corner, period. But if they're going to be there, have them sell something that I could roll my window down, take and give, and then you move out the way. I don't have to worry about you touching my car without my permission. You know, the citizens can donate the water for them to sell. They can donate the chips for them to sell. I mean, it's something that can be a middle ground.
Some way of safely allowing them to sell or perform the services for those who want them without interfering with the people who don't.
Exactly.
Okay, we got one line open, 410-481-1010. One line, 410-481-1010. We're coming to Dante, James, Thomas, and David, and we got one line open. Dante, you're on air. Dante.
Hey, what's up? How y'all doing today?
All right.
So the biggest thing is that we just don't understand the culture of these kids nowadays. Like, we live in a microwave society. Everybody wants it now. So the 12-year-old kid that people looking at like a kid, nah, this little man wants $200 Jordans, and his mom is not willing to buy them. And then the moms that are willing to buy them are sacrificing buying Jordans when little Tavon is not learning in school. So you need to you got to pick your poison in a sense. I say invest your money as opposed to buying them Jordans. Get them a tutor, you know, so they can progress in school to be able to know that they're going to be able to get a career or something like that. And I don't think that we the right way, as opposed to just telling them you need to graduate from school and go out here and get a job. I think that we need to find lucrative jobs for them once they graduate from school. If you know he's not a college bound type of child, then you need to find lucrative careers for him or her to get into fresh out of school, or find a 6-month program. Guide your children the right way so it could help you. It could help your household income, as opposed to just looking at it like, oh, just get out here and get a job. You know.
Okay.
I agree with you, Dante. And the key thing that you said is, our culture, or the culture currently, they do not have an appreciation for delayed gratification, right? So even though there are tons of opportunities out there to get a lot of money over the long run, they don't want to take 3 months, 6 months, a year to get into an apprenticeship program or to get into a training program where they can make that money down the line. They want the money here, now, today. They don't even want to wait 2 weeks for a paycheck.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's one of the main cultural issues that are driving them to being out, getting money the quickest, the easiest way that they can.
Yeah, you're right. It's social media. These kids have been being driven by social media. This is the part that y'all are missing. Nobody, these children don't even have the temperament to stand to learn a trade or nothing. You think they're going to go to trade school for 4 years? Do you think these kids... And see, the way we're going about it is all wrong. We operating behind time. We need to change the whole structure of the way we teaching the children. And you need to teach them from a business standpoint. Y'all still trying to teach these kids the old-fashioned way. They don't want that. This is why they're rebelling. And then you keep asking a question about them going down. They going downtown because there's nothing uptown.
Right. That's
leadership took it. That leadership destroyed uptown. There's nothing there.
You're right.
So they don't have no choice. Listen, the questions we asking, all this stuff is an easy fix. The conversation should be, is where the 600 something million at? Let's do a report card of how was that money.
Yeah,
where is that money going?
I'd like to know too. I'd like to know where every dime
nothing.
Is.
Who are we
before
speaking
the
with?
Listen to me. Before the pandemic, they was talking about entertainment district on Pennsylvania and North. Somebody said from Hilton to Milton. Oh.
Well,
okay.
Thomas, you're on air.
Carlton Douglas, my main man who married both himself. God knows, so did I. What's going on, Carlton? How y'all guys doing today?
What's up, Tom?
Hey, let me ask you a question, Carlton. Since all of these dirt bikes and stuff need to have supposed to have tags and stuff on them, right? What about all these scooters you see riding around here? Should they have tags on them too?
Yeah. Yeah, they should.
But they don't.
Well, none of them do. So
none of the scooters got tags on them. I'm talking about these little things where you rent to ride around.
No. They don't. No. You're talking about the commuter transportation stuff like it used to be. The little things that be all over town. Those are licensed through the city. They don't need to have tags on anything.
I guess it's kind of equivalent to like a bicycle.
And there's
only two operators, and they operate under contracts with the city that control where you can put them, who can rent them, and so forth. Those are strictly regulated.
Yeah, but they regulate anybody with a prepaid debit card to rent one of them things.
Right, but you don't need a plate on it. You don't need one. Let's go
prepaid
to...
prepaid debit card with a license.
Yeah. Let's go to David. Dave, join air.
Good afternoon.
I just
wanted to chime in on that dirt bike thing. I actually have a younger family member that's in that culture here in Baltimore, and I even asked, I'm like, nephew, why don't you guys don't just go out somewhere and ride on the, you know, on the trails and all that? He's like, oh, it's more of a culture of being defiant of riding around in the city. He say it's Philly, New York, all the major cities. It's a culture. You can build a track, but they will still live that culture of riding around the city, having fun, as they term it. So, I mean, you can spend that money on a dirt track, but it's a culture thing that they're living. They're not going to go to a dirt track.
Well, wait a second. Who are you building? We're not building the track for those who are committed to violating the law, whatever. We're building the track to give an opportunity to those who want to use the dirt bikes legally and properly. We got to decide who we're doing stuff for. The notion, and that's why when we talk about these kids, it's not all kids. It's not. I don't know what percentage it is. It's enough to make us uncomfortable. I understand that, but we got to stop talking about it as though it's the majority of our kids, because that's not true.
I think what he's saying is that in the day's day and time, the purpose of getting a dirt bike is to be illegal. You know, no one is getting a dirt bike to ride in a circle. You know, no one is doing that. If I'm getting a dirt bike, it's because I want to be out on the street with my friends, weaving in between traffic, popping wheelies. That's fun to us. And I mean, it is fun to them. You know, it's exciting. That's their culture. They're not going to buy a dirt bike to go around the track.
I know, but the problem is now we don't have any way of telling the difference. We don't know if we had a track and those who would use it lawfully will attract those who now just want to do wheelies. I don't know. The problem is we're trying to build something to suit a small percentage of the population, and when you do that, you're in fact restricting the rights and of those who would want to do it lawfully. My grandma says, "Well, wait a minute, Pop. I did everything right. How come I got to come home at 9:00? I didn't do anything wrong. What's my reward for following the rules when you're going to impose the same sanctions against me and restrictions on me as those who don't? That's the problem."
Tony, you're on air.
Good morning. Let's start with the dirt bike talk, and okay. let's be real specific. Now, Carlton made mention that he's never seen a license plate on not one dirt bike. Now, you talk about a dirt bike park, and you talk about money. Who's going to man the dirt bike park? Most of the dirt bike riders, like you said, are riding illegal. They're not going to go to a dirt bike park, for one, and I'm going to be straight specific. You're going to have drug abuse at the dirt bike park. People are going to steal each other's bikes. It's going to be all kind of harm. They don't want to drive their dirt bikes on the dirt bike in a dirt bike park. They want to ride it on the street. Now let's get to the curfew. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. If you're going to pick kids up and then ask them, no, not pick them up. If you want to go to them and ask them, hey, you want to come with me to the curfew center? Do you really think these kids going to say yes? I'm going to go to the curfew center. No. It's all a sham. It's a waste of money and everything else in between. You're going to take them to the curfew center, feed them, and then take them home. That's not feasible for what's going on. First, you said that it was going to be for this criminal behavior that was going on. These criminals, like y'all said, 15, they're not going to no rec centers no more. They're not worried about playing no basketball because that's mainly at the curfew center, not curfew center, at rec centers. If you would have started earlier with curfew violations and do it right, you'll have consistency. It's not going to be no consistency.
Thank you, Tony. Last caller for today, Ali. Ali, you on
there? How y'all doing today?
All right.
Good. See, listen, to me, this young people initiative, to me, from the mayor, it's nothing but the animals running the zoo. That's all it is. Now, you take 20, they say you can't beat 20 kids or more or less. Now, the young people will count, they got 10 people, they will separate 10, and the other 10, what can you do to them then? You know, it just don't make sense. It's not adding up. And let me say one more thing with the kids that's out here. It's not the problem with dirt bikes. It's not the problem of what they do. It's the trouble that brings with it. Just like the squeegee kids. It's not because they clean their windows. It's because the problem that they bring with it. Now, even the dirt bike park, they had one on Lombard Street. How many people went to that dirt bike to ride? You tell me. It was a couple years ago. Do y'all remember that?
I don't know.
Yeah, mm-mm. The lady started it. She up there where the trains, where the big trains was. And how many kids show up there to ride the dirt? But they don't want that. They want the thrills of riding in the street so their friends can see them popping wheelies. And that's what they like, the thrill. But
okay. I don't know if that's going to get to be resolved whatsoever. I don't know how you're going to deal with it. It needs to be dealt with, though. I can say that. I want to take this time out to say happy anniversary to the sweetheart of my life for the last 27 years, my wife, Darlene. We are celebrating 27 years today. We got married on a Pentecost Sunday on May 26, 1996. Church was so packed that the fire marshal came out and told him, don't let another Negro in here. So, darling, 27 beautiful years. Been rough now and then, but it's rough and everything. So, now, there you go.
Now you can go home.
Yes.
Without fear.
What's wrong with your man? Lamar don't want to even show up to not even a mandatory training camp.
I think they talked tough to him and he showed up the next day, right? Didn't he show up on Tuesday?
I don't know.
I don't think he showed up on Monday. Then I guess they pressed on him the importance of being there.
I think he showed up
the next day and was talking about how good it is to work with the new offensive coordinator. So.
Okay. All right.
He has time.
All right. What do you think about this? Is this debt ceiling going to be done in the next few days or maybe within the next week?
There's a more pernicious threat to the economy in this country than the issues relating to the debt. The debt ceiling is going to be taken care of. The United States is not going to default on its bond obligations. and people are going to get paid. The more pernicious threat as relates to what's going on with BRICS and the countries that are organized to abandon the dollar as the medium of exchange in their economies and to revert to the gold standard. Because what's quietly happening, what's quietly happening is that the super rich are pulling the money out of the banks and they're using it to buy gold as a hedge against that.
Mm-hmm.
If that continues, we're going to see more and more bank failures. And with more and more bank failures, you're going to see the economy tanking more and more and more.
Yep.
So that's just my prediction. And I've read things that there certainly I'm not an economist, and I've read reports that agree with me, and I've read other reports. But every investment advisor that I know of, including the ones that I represent legally, are fearful of the same consequences. And that is a far bigger threat than the one posed by the fact that the U.S. may default on its bond obligations.
Final words.
Thank you for joining us today. It is always a pleasure. I hope you have a fun and happy Memorial Day weekend. Enjoy the extra day off. I'm Tehma Smith Wilson, an attorney and small business owner in Baltimore City. I can be reached at 667-334-7242. And don't forget to check us out on YouTube, Frank Conaway Senior Show. Have a great weekend.
Bob.
Robert Dashiell, 410-547-8820. Be safe. Be sound. And be good.
And Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the number is 410-669-1738. And this has been the Frank M. Conaway Senior et al. Show with co-host Attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob DeShields, and yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. Thank you, Fats, our engineer, taking care of us. Y'all be safe out there. It's wild on Memorial Day now. Be safe. And as I always tell you, take your head, your ear, put it to the ground. Listen to the grass grow. See ya. Don't want to be. Bye.